Okay, hello everybody. My sincere apologies for not being able to present in French today. I understand most of it, but since it's then my third language, I guess it's very difficult to switch from English to Dutch to French. So something happens in my brain that I don't say proper sentences anymore. So apologies, and I'm very thankful for the opportunity to speak here today to you and for the invitation from the ministry to participate in this project. Also, thank you for the introduction. I already warned you that I tend to speak very fast, so I'll try to do it as slow as possible for you here and at home to be able to follow my presentation. So yes, indeed, I am a researcher. I'm a criminologist, actually, working at the epidemiology department in the University of Antwerp. Today, I'm presenting the results of our study, and more specifically, the results for the Wallonia-Brussels area, or the CFVB. I'm here alone today, but I'm working in a team of four people. Stephanie is my colleague and is the intern in the epidemiology department. And then Professor Kampen is a professor in statistics who supported the statistics of this project. And Guido van Hal is the head of our department in social epidemiology. Today, I'd like to give you the results of this study first, of course, for your region, but then I'll also try to explain a little bit how this compares to the international results of the other participating countries in this study. I'll discuss the results a little with you, and I, of course, as a researcher, it's very easy to make recommendations to the policy, easy for us to make them. It's harder for you to realize them, of course, in practice, but I'll certainly give you my ideas on how we can improve the prevention of maltreatment in sport. So let me start the story. Before the French community was involved, we did a couple of studies with international partners in Europe about violence in sport and child maltreatment. And maybe you remember directly before the Me Too movement, there was already a public disclosure of child sexual abuse in sport. There were the England soccer players who all testified of their child sexual abuse. I think it started in 2017. And that was at the time where we were doing a European project called Voices, in which we collected the stories of child sexual abuse in sports. And we used these voices to raise awareness on the issue in Europe and to develop educational resources. This was mainly done with the same partners as you can see here in this new partnership. Because we realized it's not enough to only bring good stories, important stories of child sexual abuse in sport. We also need to know how big the problem is. And actually, by then, the start of this project, only in Flanders and to a lesser extent in Germany, there was prevalence study available on the magnitude of the problem. So by then, only in these countries, we had an idea on how big the problem was. Here in Wallonia and Brussels, but also in the UK, for example, and in Spain and Romania, there was no scientific study available on the magnitude of the problem. So we got together with these researchers and we decided to apply for European funding to measure and to develop an instrument to measure the prevalence of interpersonal violence in sport and to make sure that we can then test it out in all these countries involved. As you can see, it's not all scientific people here in these collaborations. The World Athletics Federation was also involved, as well as Sport England and the German Sport Youth from the German Olympic Committee, which is very important because we are not going to solve this problem as researchers. So we work in close collaboration with actors from the sports world. So the aim of our study was to develop a questionnaire and to test this in implementation in these countries to provide strong data on the prevalence of violence against children in sports. With children, we mean all people below the age of 18. And we wanted to measure their experience with violence in sport, but at the same time also outside sport. Because of course, children on average spend a couple of hours per week in sport, but many, many more hours outside sport, of course. We developed a self-report instrument to measure the prevalence. And we tested it out in a sample of 18 to 30 year olds. So we didn't ask children directly. Ethically, it's very difficult to ask children directly, certainly in an online study. So we asked young adults and they retrospectively report about their experience in sport before the age of 18. There were six partners in this European study, the UK, Germany, Belgium, represented by me, so Flanders actually, Romania, Spain, and Austria. directly before, like days before we started the study, I was contacted by the ministry here, and they heard from the study and they wanted to be involved. And actually, I think you were expecting for me to do the study in both languages, but that was not the goal at the beginning. So I was very happy and delighted that we were able to construct a collaboration, and that here the ministry partly funded this project, we could take an extra sample in the Belgian population. So we ended up with two samples in Belgium, one in Flanders and one in Bohemia. For the study, and this is a very important message here, we adopted a very broad definition of violence or maltreatment, like you call it here in French. We based our definition on the Article 19 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is ratified by all countries in this study. And as you can see, it includes all forms of physical and mental violence, injury and abuse, neglect or negligent treatment, maltreatment or exploitation, including sexual abuse while in the care of parents or other legal guardians, sorry. And what is important is this definition is broad. It also includes behaviors that are mild, verbal or non-verbal, and it also includes definitions that were not, experiences that were not intended to harm, like you were saying from the definition that you used as well, there's no intention that is required to describe such behavior as violence. Indeed, even the UNCRC clearly refers to that aspect, because we know lots of people criticize the use of this type of definition. They say that all forms of violence against children, however light, are unacceptable. So the frequency or the severity or the intent to harm are not prerequisites. So it doesn't matter how often it happened and how serious it is. All forms of violence against children are not acceptable and can be prevented, should be prevented. That is why we use a very broad definition, going from milder forms of verbal violence into the most severe types of violence. Just for the record, we only conduct this study into the context of organized sports, so all recreational or competitive sport activities that are outside the school curriculum, and they involve an element of training or instruction by an adult. So included are sports camps and then sport clubs, of course, most of the activities in sport clubs, and organized sporting activities at school outside the school hours. So not included in this study are PE lessons or informal physical activities like playing soccer on the street with friends. This is not a form of organized sport. So our research question was, what is the magnitude of interpersonal violence against children that were active in sport before the age of 18? In and outside sports. Of course, when we measure the magnitude, we're also going to look for other characteristics here. What are these athletes' characteristics that we found in the study? What are the characteristics of the people that they say were responsible for this behavior? And then what are the characteristics of the circumstances? How old were they? How long did it take? Where did it take place? And were they able to disclose, to report what happened? In Flanders, we already used in 2014 a questionnaire, a self-report questionnaire that we developed in the course of my PhD study. And we used that questionnaire as a basis for this study, but we improved it. We now included more forms of interpersonal violence, and we updated it to include also online experiences of abuse, which were not so relevant back in the 2000s and earlier, and are now, of course, very relevant in today's lives of children. So before starting the questions on violence, we of course asked some questions about the demographics and the sport participation. And then we used the typology of four different types of violence: neglect, which I'll explain later, psychological violence, physical violence, and sexual violence. The sexual violence we divided into two categories: non-contact behaviors and contact behaviors. And if a respondent says yes to any of these items or to one of these items in this list, he or she also received some follow-up questions about these circumstances, how often it happened and what age they were. To be clear, we didn't say this was abuse. So we presented a list of items. I'll show you on the next slide. We didn't say this is abuse, this is violence, or this has a huge impact on you. We didn't define that for the respondent. We let them decide themselves. And we always added kind of a disclaimer or a warning before they got these questions. We say, okay, the next questions ask about your childhood and experience that are generally considered to be negative or harmful for young people. because they're in this definition from the Rights of the Child Convention. And then we say sometimes people can do or say things that hurt you or hurt your feelings that might have a negative or harmful emotional impact when you were a child. Did you experience any of these? So we ask about their personal perception of what happened to them. If some of these behaviors didn't happen to them, they will not respond to it. If it happened to them, but they don't think they were negative, they will not say it. Okay? So we ask for their perception of negative or unwanted behaviors. And these are all in total. And maybe I'll go a little bit more in detail about the category of neglect, because this is often forgotten in studies on violence in sport. So not receiving the adequate support while doing your sport and not receiving proper medical care, for example, having an injury and not getting the right treatment because your coach decides it's more important that you play on Sunday than you get the right medical care, is a form of neglect. And neglect is an official form of violence. Same for inadequate supervision. When you have to do very difficult or dangerous exercises and nobody is there to protect your safety, that's inadequate supervision. Same for inappropriate equipment. If you're doing, for example, martial arts and you don't have the proper protection to protect yourself, that's also a form of neglect. But at the same time, also often heard in higher competitive levels of sport, the absence from school. So schools drop out when a coach or a club or another federation is forcing you to drop out from school to focus on your sport career. That's a form of educational neglect. And then, of course, all kinds of unsafe conditions or circumstances in the sport infrastructure. So also a very broad concept. Psychological violence is the biggest concept that ranges from humiliations to criticism about your appearance, what we call in English body shaming. Very prevalent in sports, but also being ignored or being excluded from your team without an explanation, not being praised for any of your efforts. Maybe that doesn't sound so severe, but imagine that you're in school, you're trying to read your first sentences when you're 6 years old, and you're trying and trying, and never your teacher says, that's good, that's okay, you're doing well. Right? So that's the issue of not being praised for your efforts. To verbal aggression and abuse, verbal threats, for example, having to perform at unrealistic high expectations and initiation games or rites, what we call in Flemish dope ritueel, rites of passage that are in a psychological harmful nature. Physical violence, of course, the most important or well-known aspect of physical violence is physical assault, all types of physical assault to your body. But in sport, we also added more forms of physical violence, like, for example, having to play while you're injured or while you're totally exhausted or sick. So somebody's forcing you to play or to train while you cannot do it anymore. Also being forced to take supplements like doping to enhance your performance. Remember, we asked this to people who respond about their childhood. So we're talking here about children. Also, of course, physical harmful initiation rites, and then exercise is a form of punishment, very well known in sports. For example, there's a little race during training, you end last, and because you end last, you have to do 100 push-ups. That's exercise being used as a form of punishment. Also in gymnastics, I heard stories that, okay, you gained 200 grams of weight, so now you have to run 100 extra laps before or after training. That's physical exercise as a form of punishment. And then actually the last form of violence that we unfortunately know best, sexual violence, from non-contact sexual violence, like sexual comments or looks or jokes, sexual images being produced from you or being shared with other people without your consent, being have to be undressed in front of others and being flashed at, so exhibitionism actually online or in person. Contact sexual violence last goes from kissing and sexual touching, of course, to the most extreme types of physical or sexual violence, which are rape or attempts to rape. As you can see, there's lots of variation in severity in this concept that we studied. So we produced this questionnaire and we produced it in English. The model version of the questionnaire was, of course, English. And before we translated it, we tested it 2 times in a UK audience. A pretest is a qualitative test in which we sit next to the respondent and we listen while he or she fills in the questionnaire and gives feedback on the questionnaire. Then in an online version, we already tested with 300 persons from our target audience in the UK. Then we, of course, did some quality improvements after these tests, and then we translated it into all the languages. And because of the funding and the support of the ministry here, we could also translate it into French. And this was done by an official translating office and being checked by new people here at the ministry in order to make sure it was of high quality. In each of these steps, of course, we took lots of ethical considerations. My university looked at the whole procedure and gave ethical clearance to do this study. We made sure that every participant knew that this is voluntary, what we're doing here. They could stop at any moment because we know that for people who live through severe experience, such a questionnaire could be triggering, could be emotional or create emotional distress. And also at several points in the questionnaire, we added some information where they can find helplines, where they can find help or where they can talk, where they, who they could contact if they wanted to talk to somebody in relation to the experiences that we surveyed in the questionnaire. So this was a very cautious and very precise preparation of the study. We were ready to launch a study in November last year, so 1 year ago. And so the agency, the international agency, Ipsos Mori, helped us with taking a representative sample from general society. We didn't ask sport clubs for participants because we know if you suffered something severe in sport, it's likely you're not in sport anymore, that you dropped out from sport. So we asked a sample from general society in the age of 18 to 30 years old, and they were pre-screened on having participated in organized sport before the age of 18. As you can see, data collection in the Wallonia and Brussels region went very fluent, and in 20 days, the data collection was complete. This was similar to all other countries. Only in Flanders, it took a little bit longer. And that was not new to the agency because they say that Flemish people are not surveillance and it takes them longer to reply to a survey. But here in Wallonia and Brussels, it was very smooth. In total, all of these countries took the same sample of 1,472 participants in all of these countries, and in Belgium, the double. So we ended up with more than 10,000 respondents. And because of this large sample, we had a good representation. We took representative samples for males, females, in the different ages between 18 and 30 years old. And because we have lots of variation, we also have people from different types of sexual orientation, people with a disability, people without a disability, people from all different ethnic backgrounds are included in this study. In Belgium, there's almost 3,000 respondents, half male, half female, and 1% saying they have an other gender orientation. And then, of course, a quite representative variation of sexual orientations, with 9 people saying they have a disability and 8 people saying they participated in sport for people with a disability only. 14% saying that they belong to an ethnic minority. Maybe even more interesting for you, I'll now show you the sample characteristics for the Wallonia-Brussels sample, in which still very representative for age, mean age of 24, and biological sex. Very normal sexual orientation variety in the sample. 6 people saying they have disability, but 7 people saying I participated in disability sports. 12% of people say they participated both in sport for people with disability, and also for people sports for people without disability. 13% say themselves that they belong to an ethnic minority here, where they live here in Brussels or in India. Now, we also asked what the highest level of sports was they reached in competitive sport before the age of 18. And as you can see, this is also quite a good representation of the general population, with almost half of them saying I did sport, but only at recreational level. I was not involved in competitive or competition sports. 33% says, yes, I was active in competition, but only at the local or a club level. Then 15% regional, 8% national, and 2%, almost 2% of people involved here said, yes, I already competed at international competitions before the age of 18. I don't know whether that perfectly fits, of course, your definition of elite sports. It's self-reported information, people saying, yes, I participated in international sports. In Belgium, the most common sports were for men, soccer, basket, swimming, and tennis. In women, it was dance, swimming, gymnastics, and equestrian, so horse riding, which is also, I think, very comparable to the general samples. Now, this is the main slide of my presentation because these are the results for the different types of violence broad sense violence in the sample of Wallonia and Brussels. Unfortunately, these numbers are high, and they're high for each type of violence, but most attention here, of course, in this slide go to psychological violence. Psychological violence is in this study, but also in all other studies found in sport and outside sport, the most prevalent form of violence against children. Almost 70% here in Wallonia and Brussels say they have at least one experience. So if they say yes to one of these 9 questions in psychological violence, they are already included in this number here. So that's what we call the low threshold measure. So there's one experience that when you say yes to, even if it happens only once to you, you're included in this number. Also very high are physical violence and both non-contact violence and neglect. The least prevalent type is contact sexual violence, luckily, but still 1 in 4 of these participants experience that type of violence while in sports. So these are the numbers for experiences in sport only. Maybe this is a very complex slide and maybe you don't have to look to all the numbers, but look at the one in the center. These are the number of people in the total sample that say, I suffered all of these types of violence in sport at least once. And this is a very high number. 1 in 5 athletes experience at least one experience of all of the 5 different types of violence. That's quite a lot. And it also shows us that there's a big overlap. So maltreatment of children is a problem. And sometimes it has a physical nature. Sometimes it has a psychological nature. Sometimes it has sexual nature. But it's very much correlated. So children often suffer all of these types. For example, if you look at the purple side of the contact sexual violence there on the right, only 0.6% of people have experience of contact violence only. So if they experience sexual violence, it's very likely they also experience other type of violence. That's very important, of course, for prevention. So I like your approach. I like the way that you define this by maltreatment in general, because actually it doesn't matter that much what type it is. General prevention should target all types of interpersonal violence. Now, what are the most reported experiences? That's punishment with physical exercise, humiliation, not being praised for your efforts or achievements, excessive negative critique on appearance, ignorance and exclusion, and verbal abuse. All of them, except for the first one, are forms of psychological violence. So that explains why this number is so high. And all of these separate experiences are reported by more than 30% of the athletes or of the sample. Less common were experiences with sexual contact violence. These are less prevalent, but to be honest, 8 or 9% of people saying that they suffered contact sexual violence, each of these items in the context of sport is still very high. So we didn't find any item that was less than 8% prevalent in our sample. Now, looking at each of the 5 types separately, I'll show you now 5 slides, and always I'll show you first the Belgian numbers in and outside sport, then the Wallonia-Brussels numbers, and then just for comparison, also the Flanders numbers. Here you can see that 36% of people in Belgium experience neglect in sport, but also outside sport. So you see a little difference between 36, that's because of rounding the numbers. So it was a little bit higher, 36.4, and it was, I think, 35.8 in outside sport. So actually quite of the similar levels. And in Wallonia and Brussels, we know that 40% of respondents, if Flanders a little bit lower. Psychological violence, the most prevalent form, inside sport, 63%. Outside sport, even higher, 71%. Again, a little bit higher in Wallonia and Brussels compared to the total and compared to Flanders, 68 in sport and 76 outside sport. So 3/4 of all people who say yes, outside sport, I experienced psychological violence. Physical violence here, again, we see a difference here that it's a little bit higher in Wallonia and Brussels compared to Flanders, but the difference is very low. And also remarkable in this slide, they suffer more physical violence in sport than outside sport. And that probably has to do with that item, physical exercise as a form of punishment that was so prevalent and that is so common in sport, luckily less prevalent outside sport. We don't do that in schools or in music schools. They don't use physical exercise as a form of punishment. It's some behavior that is very normalized in sport clubs, in the culture of sport, much less outside sport, luckily. Now, contact sexual violence is very prevalent as well, 36 in general and 41% in your region. However, it's much more prevalent outside sports. So people in the study are confronted with sexual intimidation even more outside sport than they are in sport. Think about in school, in their family, at the street, in public spaces, even up to 60% in Bologna and Brussels. And then the least prevalent form, contact sexual violence. Again, we see the same trends as with the non-contact sexual violence. It happens more outside sport, but still in sport, in Bologna and Brussels, 1 in 4 reports contact sexual violence, which is actually a very, very high number. European prevalence estimates always say 1 in 5 children experience sexual abuse before the age of 18. Well, now here we see it's 1 in 4 in our sample. Now, how does this compare to our neighbor countries, the 6 countries that were included in the study? We see that the results here, if you look at the total number for each type of violence, are very similar to what we now report here in Wallonia and Brussels, although they are a little bit lower for some forms. I'll try to explain that to you in a second. Here you see as well for each of, so here we take the interpersonal violence in total. And as you can see here, Wallonia and Brussels in red, both in and outside sport, you are at the, or this region scores at the high end of the, compared to the other countries. However, as you can see, the differences are very, very small. Compare it, for example, to Germany, where we score 80% of violence in sport and they 78, and outside sport 86 to 81. Statistically, these are significant differences. So we checked, and these are statistically different because of course we have a very big sample, so the power of our measurements is very high. But in practice, what does this mean, this difference? Me as a researcher looking at these numbers, I don't see much difference that is really relevant for practice. The numbers are high in all of these countries. In specific forms, of course, there is a little bit more variation. I'll show it to you here, but in general, they're all in the same category. So the extent of violence is the same in all of these countries. As you can see, in all types of violence, the difference between all of these countries, from the minimum to the maximum, is only 10 or a little bit more than 10%. Only in physical violence, we find a big difference. From 32% in Austria to 52% here in Bologna and Brussels. So physical violence and non-contact sexual violence are most prevalent in our region here. Again, do not draw very strong conclusions on this data. This is just a statistical difference. It's not that meaningful because, of course, we work with prevalence estimates. It's people's personal opinions. It's very a sensitive issue. So don't put too much emphasis on the details of these numbers, but just look at the general trends here. And the general trend for sure here is that it's prevalent in all of the 6 participating countries, unfortunately. The most remarkable result of our study is that boys report more violence in all of the 5 different types compared to girls. This is new. This is new inside sport and also outside sport. We have some studies saying that there's more physical violence between men compared to physical violence towards women in extrafamilial settings, so outside the family. But this is the first study that found the difference from all of the different types. So also for neglect, also for sexual violence, it's been reported more in the study by young men compared to young women in sports. And not only men and boys are vulnerable, we see higher exposure rates in their group, but also in other groups. Apologies if that is a too complex slide, but let's go to it one by one. The total is represented in blue. And then I've selected 4 of what we call vulnerable subgroups. So groups where we know they have a higher exposure rate to violence in general. We know that from previous study in and outside sport. And indeed, again, we find the same result in this study. For example, the LGBTQI community scores higher on all types of violence and certainly on sexual violence. You see a big difference there from 41 to almost 60% in non-contact sexual violence. Same for international athletes, also not new. These are several explanations. If you are as a child in a high performance environment, we know the pressure is high. We know there's lots at stake. So its boundaries are being pushed and transgressed, often at physical level, but also at level of psychological and even sometimes sexual level. So we knew that elite athletes report more violence, not only because of this atmosphere in elite sport, but also, of course, because of the exposure time. If you do sports one time a week, 1 hour, then you are being exposed to possible violence in sport for 1 hour a week. If you are an elite gymnast and from 6 years on, you're training 20, even 30 hours per week in that environment, of course, you're more likely to be exposed to violence. So that certainly also explains the higher exposure rate for elite athletes. Unfortunately, also we see an increase if we compare the ethnic minority people compared to the total sample, also for all types of violence. And I'm very sad to report that, again, for people with disability, of who we already know, it's so much more difficult for them to find access to good sport and physical activity. They report super high rates here of interpersonal violence. You see up to 90%. So almost all of them report at least one negative experience while doing sport. And that's a very sad but important finding. And I think if you consider prevention strategies, this should always be the top of your mind, that these prevention strategies work very inclusively and even with more detail and attention for these populations. Now, there's lots of discussion, and I did this presentation already on Tuesday and Wednesday in Flanders. And of course, there's critique coming saying, okay, but if all of this is violence, then okay, we better stop sport because then everybody has experienced violence. And of course, these rates are so super high. Are you really sure that all these types experience for them are violent? This is an important discussion. From a scientific point of view and from a pedagogical point of view, it's super important to have a broad view on what behaviors are negative and possibly harmful. I didn't invent these behaviors. It's the UNCRC, so the International Convention for the Rights of the Child, that says all of these behaviors are potentially harmful for children. We don't say they are harmful and they had a very big impact on all of these respondents, but at least they still report it to be negative. So that's very important to keep in mind. Now, as you remember, this goes from very mild forms to very severe forms of violence. And that's why we try to make a little bit of a classification between milder forms to very severe forms of violence. And we took into account the severity of an individual item and also the reported frequency. So how often was this athlete being confronted with this behavior? And then we were able to present to you now a severity classification. There's always a population of people, luckily in sport, who did not have any experience. Those are in blue here in these diagrams. But then there's the mild, moderate, and severe categorization. I was hoping to see lots of orange here on these pie charts, because that means that it was only a one-time experience or only experiencing very mild forms of maltreatment. Unfortunately, there's lots of gray and yellow, so pointing at moderate and severe experience here. Both in neglect, psychological violence, and physical violence. So even the psychological forms of violence that we often consider as normal or necessary for a child to be tough in sport, to get discipline in sport, well, 40% of all people in this sample say they suffered severe forms of psychological violence. So even after putting a severity classification on the data, we still end up with 40% of what you remember, the 68 in total. So most of these experiences are severe and not mild or moderate. That image is even more clear if we look at sexual violence. In contact sexual violence, and we're talking about children here, there is no mild form. Being kissed or being sexually assaulted, if you're a child, we all know what the penal code is, what the criminal law is in our country. Children below the age of 16 are not able to be involved in sexual activities. It doesn't exist. So even if you were sexually assaulted only once, it's already a moderate or even severe experience of sexual violence. So that's why you don't see mild experiences in contact sexual violence. But even in the non-contact, so what we call sexual intimidation, because of the severity of the experience or the repeated frequency, lots of them end up in the category of moderate or even severe non-contact experiences with sexual violence. Now, just a little bit more information. I know it's a lot of data, so I won't go in too much detail, but just a little bit of information on what happens then? What do we experience? When did it start? And we see that in physical and sexual, physical and psychological violence, the start age is very young. So we're talking here about children between 7 and 30 years old. Most of them, they say, on the question, how old were you when it started? They say somewhere between 7 and 13 years old. In neglect and sexual violence, the age is a little bit older. So that probably is related to puberty or even after puberty, the first confrontation or experience with sexual violence. We also asked, how old were you when it stopped? The majority says about 60% before the age of 18. But very surprisingly, 1 in 4 says, I was older than 18, or even it's still ongoing today. Today they're between 18 and 30 years old. I think about 10% of them said it's still ongoing today. So maltreatment in sport, of course, doesn't stop at the time when they become adults. Athletes should be protected much longer. Athletes are vulnerable per se, in for sure these vulnerable subcategories. So the problem of maltreatment doesn't stop at 18. They don't become independent adults that can take care of everything for themselves at the time, at the date where they become 18. So that's important to keep in mind, of course, although we only focused on children in this survey. The duration, 1 in 6 says it was less than 1 day, so we can conclude that it's a one-off event, it happens once, but 5 in 6 athletes says it took several days, weeks, months, and a relevant proportion of the sample said it took 2 years or even longer. So there's a very long duration. So this is not something that happens by accident or that happens just once. This is actually a chronic exposure to maltreatment in sports. This is probably an obvious question, but where did it take place? Most of them say in or around the sport facility, but also very importantly, changing rooms or treatment rooms, where treatment or changing or locker or showering takes place. And in sexual violence, we note there's also 2 other types of locations that came into the picture, at home of the athlete, of the person that was responsible, including the staff or other athletes, so personal private homes, and also in cars towards competitions or toward training. That's also an important location for sexual violence. Now, who did it? Again, we asked the participants themselves. This is not the police that says this or this or this person was guilty of this behavior. It's self-reported information from the athlete, him or herself. So we asked them, who did this to you? 1 in 4 says it was one single person. 3 out of 4 say there were more. So it didn't happen with one person, many people did that to me. And very clear in the sexual intimidation questions, so non-contact sexual violence, many of them said it was 5 or even more than 5 people. So think about sexual remarks, sexual jokes towards children, sexual looks, it happens not by one person, but they experienced that from several persons in the sport organization. 1/2 of those were men only, so they report only men who did that. 1/4 said it was men and females, so a combination of men and women who did this to me. And up to 1 in 5 said it was women only. And this is also a surprise, actually. I don't think we often focus on females as possible perpetrators of any types of violence. But certainly in psychological violence, there are a proportion of perpetratorship that is not negligible, or how can I say that in English properly. So don't forget that there is a population of women, both athletes and coaching and staff, that are responsible for maltreatment in sports. So lastly, I'll tell you a little bit about the role of the perpetrator. Most of the time, it's somebody who's known to the athlete. We also know that from general child maltreatment and abuse research, it's not that often an unknown person that attacks the child, kidnaps the child, and doesn't know. It's more often something that happens between people who know each other. And in the majority of these numbers, if we ask these athletes who did this to you, they say it's a peer athlete. It was somebody in my own team, in my own club, or it was somebody from another team, another club, but they were minors. So this is behavior from children to other children. So what we call peer-to-peer behavior. Only in physical violence and neglect, we see more coaches. Of course, a child cannot be responsible for neglecting another child. So that's obvious that in neglect, we see lots more higher percentage of coaches. Just for your information, only 1 in 5, so 20% of sexual violence is being committed by a trainer or a coach. I don't know about you in Wallonia and Brussels, but in Flanders and also abroad, cases that are reported to the media of child sexual abuse are always targeting the coach as the perpetrator. We see reports of criminal court cases. We hear stories from survivors. There's lots of attention on this type of abuse. And of course, it's one of the most severe types of sexual violence or maltreatment in general. But please don't forget that lots of the violence forms in other types is happening by peers mainly. So it happens between the children themselves in the sport organization. Besides coaches and athletes, we also see to a lesser extent other people responsible, like people in the sports personnel, management, paramedical staff, people in the sport organization, but also parents on the sideline, like you have this in your module, how do parents behave on the sideline of the soccer field, for example, and other spectators that are known or sometimes even unknown to the child. Then we often think about verbal abuse, of course, types of psychological violence in a verbal way. Here, this slide, the final slide on the data is, we asked them, were you able to tell somebody about what happened? And if you did, who did you tell? And here, please focus on the yellow bars here. Only 5 or at most 6% of these athletes were able to inform somebody in their sport club or in the sport organization. That is a very, very tiny amount of athletes that were able to tell somebody or that were willing to trust somebody in the organization to tell them. This also shows that many sport organizations don't know how big the problem is because nobody told them. They're not informed about what's happening with their athletes. Most of the athletes prefer not to tell anybody because they don't trust it, because they don't think it's severe, because they're not able to tell it. And if they do, most of the time they take into confidence somebody in the family or one of their friends. That's the most common person that they share their experience with, or they disclose their or their experiences. Of course, in severe cases, and you see that in contact sexual violence, they were able to inform somebody outside sport, like, for example, somebody at school, somebody at the police, somebody at an official victim organization. So there, the percentage is a little bit higher. But in general, most of them do not disclose. And if they do, it's in informal instances like family and friends. Okay, I hope you're still with me. These were all the data. Concluding, this data is actually very easy. All forms of violence, of maltreatment, are present in this study and in this population in Wallonia and Brussels. We see, of course, lots of differences in type, frequency, and severity. And we should be able to grasp the details here in this data. But in general, we know it's prevalent in all its types. And the prevalence rates that we found here in Wallonia and Brussels are similar to the EU countries. I hope I stressed that enough, that I'm not saying here to you that you were the worst student in the European class. You're not. Statistically, of course, there are some higher numbers, specifically for physical violence. But the numbers that we found are so closely related that we don't see a significant impact in practice. Very importantly, I repeat that boys experience more interpersonal violence in sports, and we didn't pay enough attention to that, both in practice, in policy, and in research. So we should be very aware of this finding and repeat it in future studies to see whether we find the same differences. And lastly, what I just told you, these negative experiences are not often being disclosed in the sport organization. Now, why is this important? In this, I think for your region, it's very important because it's the first time that we do a study of this size into negative experiences in sports. And not only here, but also in several EU countries, it's the first time. So we now have a good instrument. We measured it with the same methodologies in all of these countries. So we have some comparison data now, and we can use this for comparison between countries, but also for you, comparison over the longer term to repeat it in the future. This was a large sample and it was representative, so you can use it to get an idea of how big the problem is in the total population of people active in sports. And it was very recent. Of course, they were adults at the time they completed the questionnaire, but their time in sport is not dating back to the 70s. We can't say this is historic abuse. This is very recent. It's happening right now in sport. Please also remember that because of the broad definition in violence, we get a broader picture of the total problem, and we don't only focus on the criminal types of violence in sports. I think the questionnaire is also very useful for you because it is developed by a consortium of experts, not only in sport, but also in child maltreatment. So it gives a very clear view on what violence against child can be. Of course, be careful with these results. This is just an estimation. It's people's self-reports. We ask them very sensitive questions. So there could be a bias in there. We know from research that the bias is often an underreporting rather than overreporting. People are not making things up in this questionnaire. People are more likely to forget something that happened in the past and not report all of their behaviors. So don't think this is an overestimation. Actually, it's more likely that it's an underestimation. Maybe this is an important slide too. What do these numbers don't say? I repeat this here often. All these participants who report this type of experience, we didn't ask them, are you a victim? Do you feel victimized? How much pain was being caused by this behavior? How harmful was it? That was not our research question. We just wanted to measure how big is the problem in total. So we can't say anything about impact. We also don't know what impact each of these different experiences had on them. Were they equally impactful? Were they equally harmful? Or were some experiences not harmful at all, which is also likely? It's very likely that some of them didn't have any impact, so please don't forget that. We didn't also say here that the number is bigger in Wallonia and Brussels than compared to other countries, but we also can't say anything about prevention here in Wallonia and Brussels. We didn't measure this. We can't say that the number is higher or lower because of your prevention policy. We can't say it works, but we can't say it doesn't work either. I think the work that you're doing started only recently, and we don't have a measurement to compare. There was no baseline measurement before you started all of your actions. This could be considered as a good baseline measurement. And this could be repeated in 2-3 years. And it's even likely that when you start focusing like you are doing on prevention and education and awareness raising, these numbers even go up in the beginning. Because if people start to realize how broad the concept is, and whether it's okay for them to acknowledge what happened to them, and that it's okay for them to fill this in the questionnaire, it is possible that we even see an increase. But after years and years of trying to prevent and implementing your strategy, I think if you repeat this questionnaire over the long term, you will see a trend. And hopefully, after a couple of times, we see stabilization, in the best case, a decrease of these numbers. So please don't be discouraged by that, because that's not the goal of this study. What we can say after this study is that it's a broad concept and it's present here in sports in several types, in several forms and several diversities. However, it's even more present outside sports. Maybe that's not surprising because all of these people also have a life outside sports, but don't forget that it's children coming into sport. It's very likely that they have negative experience already outside sports, and we should be aware of that and be able to help children in that situation. What is certainly true is that for now, today, we don't protect them enough. Not here and not in all of the other countries. Remember, UK is also included in the study. They started their child protection in sports initiatives already in the 1990s, and they have quite similar results. Is that because they're still raising awareness and people are still reporting more? Or is that because prevention fails at certain levels? We don't know. We can't compare that. So while these numbers are very similar, the reasons for that can be very different, depending on the context of all these countries involved. But none of these countries is having numbers that we can be proud of course. And there's work to do in all of these countries. Lots of these behaviors are not being discussed in sport yet, that will be normalized. And that is something to work with. It's very hard. If we in sport still believe that it's a good way to discipline children by giving them physical exercise as a punishment, if we still believe that, then we cannot solve the problem. If we're not convinced that it's something that is harmful, possibly harmful or negative, then of course there's lots of other normalization, there's lots of education to do first before you can really prevent the issue. And that's why I suggest to you to use this as a baseline measurement and to commission monitoring research every 2 or 3 years to see where this trend is going. Now, I'm always the messenger of very bad news. As a criminologist, of course, it's always the non-fun stuff. But I want to show you this image. We also asked these participants, if you look back to your time in sports, how do you consider your participation in sport? And they could choose on a scale from very poor, very bad, very negative, to very good. And look at the green parts here in this pie chart. More than 85% of respondents say it was good or even very good. What does this tell us? That everything is good and that violence doesn't matter? I don't think so. I think normalization of all these behaviors has a very big role to play. But what we can conclude here that despite all of this, lots of children enjoy sports, see sport as a very good thing, and this is gold in our hands. We can use sports to make them feel safe, to make them feel empowered to the exposure of violence, not only in sport, but also outside sport. So it's not all that bad. In general, they remember the good things of sport as well. So if I may, I'll put this in a paper as well so you can use it further. I'll briefly go into some of the recommendations. And first of all, to US governmental actors, I think all of your policies in and outside sports should of course include child protection and safeguarding measures that are applicable to sport. Sport is a proper setting in which we should take care of children's safety. So it's not only the family and at school, sport is also a setting in which violence can take place. And as I said, please monitor this with research so that we can spot the trends on the longer term. I think you already tried to provide an independent body or agency in which people can ask for support and help. And it's very important that it's neutral, that it's not linked to the sport organization too much, because we know many of these perpetrators are known to the victim. And we know how small sport clubs can be. So probably the person can be related to somebody on the board, and then somebody will not feel the trust or not feel safe to report this. So please make it independent. And make sure that you help your sport federations to do this. It's very difficult. It's a very difficult matter. It's not their core business. So please provide, for example, financial incentives and support and education to all of the federations that are willing to start working on this issue. They really need help. And they need collaboration with IAPACA, for example, because there is much more expertise on the issue of child maltreatment than currently is available in sport federations. What we struggle with in Flanders and in several other countries that already started safeguarding strategies is that federations already know what to do and have good frameworks in place, but it's difficult for them to reach the local level. With all those volunteers working in sport clubs, how do we get the knowledge from the level of federations to the level of these local sport clubs where all these volunteers are protecting children on a daily basis? And how do we do that? That's a big challenge, I think. Sport federations themselves should, of course, acknowledge the problems in all its forms and should make sure that children's rights are part of every decision. And I would say, of course, put it at the top of your priorities in every decision. Children's rights and athletes' safety is always for in every decision. I hope these federations can use this data to start their strategic policy work from, so that they look at the data first, that they know which types of violence are most prevalent, that they know that peer-to-peer violence is very important, so that they know that their policy works with the data that we see at the moment. And when they are implementing measures, I hope they are able to measure the efficacy. Does it really help what we're doing? We think that installing a code of conduct is helpful, but do we know? Do we have the data to show that it's better? That people commit less violence when they are when they signed this code of conduct or when they have this local contact person. So if I got $1 million for you to help you in this organization, I would invest all of it in training and education. I think that's the most important aspect. Of course, we need to have repressive measures. We need to have a system where you can do complaints and do punishments in criminal, but also in disciplinary courts. But education is key here. Too many people in sport don't know that it exists. They don't know what signs are. They don't know what to do and how to intervene if they see something. So invest it all. And I would say those working with children or high performance athletes in sport, they should all have a training and it should be compulsory. We did it in Flanders. We provided them and it was not mandatory. And only 6 or 8% of sport clubs then decided to work on the topic. So it's not a topic that people want to learn about. You have to, it's a top-down approach for several things. And I think compulsory training and education is key here for sports personnel that is working with children and high-level athletes. So I already told you about contact points independently, but also very close to the child. So in Flanders, we use the local contact points for integrity that are in local sport clubs, so not neutral people that can be contacted. And then there's my number three recommendation is focusing on the bystanders so that actually all of us parents bringing our children to sport clubs, us sport personnel, sport managers, the bystander has the most important role here. We cannot ask the victim to defend him or herself or to be so empowered and take responsibility to speak up. We cannot ask that from a child. Perpetration, we will not be able to stop all types of perpetration, but we can feel responsible, all of us, for seeing signs. So I think, putting more emphasis on bystander prevention and education is also key. These trainings, of course, should be focusing on all types of interpersonal violence, but also victimization of males and females. So make sure that the materials that we make, that they also address boys. Boys are less inclined to speak about what's negative than girls in this department. So it's important to make sure that they understand your prevention materials. And lastly, everything that we do here, we focus on children because that's our main target group of the study, but it doesn't say anything about adult health. And we know there is a continuation of violence after the age of 18. So focus on children first, but be mindful that athlete safety doesn't stop at 18. And we need to, of course, also prevent them after the age of 18. So thank you for your attention, for paying so much attention to these numbers. I know it's a lot, and I hope that it's only a first introduction to you for the numbers. And here is the link to the full study, which gives you lots more detail and information about all of these results. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. Un grand merci pour cette présentation. Merci beaucoup de ça. Félicitations à l'intérêt sur le chat. Il y a Vico aussi pour poser des questions. Je ne sais pas s'il y a des questions qui souhaitent être posées.
L'équipe Ulysse, to read the question in English.
Oh, they're going to chat.
Voilà, merci pour cet exposé vraiment éclairant. Et comme tu dis, ce n'est pas un exposé sur lequel on va pleurer, se plaindre. Je pense que c'est une base. Tu l'as dit à demi-mot à travers des exemples que tu as donnés. On est bien dans des problèmes de maltraitance interpersonnelle, mais ces maltraitances interpersonnelles, elles sont aussi la résultante d'une maltraitance que tu ne cites pas, mais tu le cites dans tes exemples, qui est la maltraitance institutionnelle. Quand tu dis que les personnes handicapées n'ont pas accès à des activités, quand on parle de sport compétitif et qu'on voit très peu d'endroits où des enfants peuvent faire et des adultes peuvent faire du sport sans qu'il y ait cet aspect de compétition, quand on voit l'impact des médias également, on parle de maillon faible, on parle de collants, on parle de tout ça, toutes ces violences institutionnelles est quelque part aussi amène à cette violence interpersonnelle. Je pense qu'il y a un lien qui est là et sur lequel nous devons nous aussi. Et tu le disais à la fin de ton exposé sur le travail avec les fédérations, fédérations et institutions. Ce travail-là, pour moi, en termes de prévalence, est très important.
Yes, I totally agree. And we chose the focus of the study on interpersonal violence, so violence between persons. But knowing that the number of victimization that we find here, it is lots more than an individual problem. This is not an interpersonal problem only. The rates are so high that there's only one explanation, that some of this violence is institutionalized. The climate is so conducive that lots of these experiences are being allowed to happen in the sport organization. And indeed, it has to do with norms and values in sports, in sport cultures, in sports organizations, but it also has very practical reasons. The fact that in sports, there's lots of practical opportunities like changing rooms and taking a shower together, taking your phone into the locker rooms and taking pictures and then harassing people with these pictures, lots of physical touching in the context of sports, which is not due to the institution itself, but to the nature of the organization and the nature of doing sports and giving sports to children. These are specific risk factors that are bigger than the individual level, that are in the culture, that are in the circumstances where violence takes place. And that indeed, there's no need of pointing at several people who do it wrong. It's the culture and the circumstances that we should take into account. And indeed there, the institutional approach should be to include that in safeguarding measures, that we know we have some difficult areas, we have some specific risk factors because we do sports, because we work with young children, because there's the pressure of competition, because there's mediatization of what we do, because there's lots of money involved in some sports. And these are all of them are extra elements that we need to be alarmed, like, okay, we have some specific risks and we need to attack them. And these are maybe bigger in sports than in other societies or the parts of our society. Yeah, that's I hope it's a part of an answer to your question, but every sector in society needs to do that exercise, kind of a risk assessment. Where are the different fields in our sector that are more inclined to maltreatment or violence in any type? And in sport, we have several, due to things in the organization and practical stuff, but also due to the culture that is still present in competitive sports. And one very important issue, but I know you're working on that as well, is gender equality. We know that in organizations where there's less gender equality, there's more sexual intimidation. There's higher rates of sexual intimidation of women, but also of LGBTQI. And these are institutional forms of discrimination and violence. And this can be an, same for athletes' sports and children's sports and decision-making. These aspects don't only work for improving gender equality, doing prevention on this issue will also help to prevent maltreatment in sport. Okay, thank you.
Qui demandait si d'autres études étaient déjà planifiées dans le futur pour mesurer l'impact des mesures
parentales,
notamment pour faire la différence par rapport au UK qui a déjà mis en place des mesures, mais finalement on mesure difficilement l'impact. Mm-hmm.
So, in the scope of this project, unfortunately, there's no further research on the impact of experiences. I'm a criminologist and we do epidemiology. So criminal epidemiology means that we're trying to measure how big the problem is. To be able to measure the impact, it requires another strategy. I think there we should work with a cross-sectional design in which you ask people questions, again, a representative sample, in which you ask them questions about their general health, their quality of life, physical health, psychological distress. And that is more of a medical design. And that is a totally different design from what we did here. And then it's very difficult to calculate what impact is. So what do you think that the most relevant impact is for violence? We don't know. We think it's anxiety and depression. Sometimes it's even suicide, drug problems. And there's lots of different impacts that such behavior can have on the short term and also on the long term. So if you want to measure that in total, you need to come up with a sample of people from very different age groups, because the long-term consequences are often only visible after 20 or 30 years after these experiences. We know from people, for example, in child sexual abuse, that it sometimes even takes 10 years to only talk about these experiences for the first time. So then only the effects and the treatment can only work after so many time. So that was not possible in this study to include that, because these young people were still too young being at the time they were participating in the study, we would not see all the long-term impacts. And to be honest, I think that is more of a study that, I don't think it's so urgent to do that study on impact, because we know the impact of child maltreatment is already documented outside sports. And I don't see any reasons to believe that a child that's being abused outside sport and inside sport have different outcomes. So I believe that violence in sport can have as damaging impacts in sport as it has outside sport. So from the sport point of view, that is not the most important thing to know, because we already know outside sport. That's not to avoid your question. So in this study, no, but I know that after this study, there's lots of other European initiatives. And I hope that we, and here, of course, again, in collaboration with the ministry, can be part of future research in which not only the impact will be studied, but also perception of the athletes themselves and normalization of the behavior. So is this really very impactful? Because of sport, are people maybe more inclined to accept this behavior and not report negative experiences? That's a very interesting research question, but we should come up with a totally different research design to measure that.
Par rapport à la perception notamment de la violence dans le sport, on a tendance à magnifier certaines formes de souffrance physique en disant effectivement le sport, ben, l'entraînement, la souffrance physique permet d'atteindre un niveau de performance plus élevé. Mm-hmm. Comment est-ce qu'on peut travailler sur cette perception qui peut dire plus différemment par l'entraîneur qui donne un entraînement, qui planifie quelque chose par rapport à un athlète qui manifeste une motivation, mais à quel moment on bascule dans la violence?
Mm-hmm. So where is actually the boundary between acceptable coaching behavior and pushing boundaries, and then where does violence start? Yeah, very complicated issue. I don't have the answer, and I also think it's very personal and subjective, depending on the child, depending on the athletes, and even depending on the day. It is very likely that the child says, yes, last week that that kind of behavior or that kind of yelling to me was okay, but today I can't take it. So it's very personal. And then we come back to, okay, sport is about pushing boundaries and about improving yourself and about being the best and being pushed to the maximum level that you can achieve. My question is it, do we really think that putting discipline, including verbal abuse and threats and physical punishment, do we really think that is the best way of pushing this motivation and the performance of these athletes better? Does it really have to be this way? Isn't there a way of working with the internal motivation that many of our athletes already have? Sometimes they even have too much, and the coach should be there to say, take it easy and make it safe, and we're not going to do too much. So I think there's other ways of motivating children and of raising their performance. And I think we know now from pedagogical research that using punishment or using fear or using physical punishment and or physical extortion or exhaustion and playing through pains like injuries, it doesn't help on the long term. It might help on the short term, and that's a little bit tricky, because if you install this culture of fear and discipline and verbal abuse, children can be very focused on avoiding these fears and avoiding that abuse. They are so focused, I can't fall off the beam, because then he will tell me I'm a fat cow, and then he will do this and this again. And then he will be so focused on the short term that it might even work for a short term. But we know from pedagogical research and social psychology that this is not the way to cultivate good athlete health and good athlete performance on the long term. It doesn't help. And so I'm the first one to sit down with this coach and then discuss where does discipline stops and where does violence starts? How we can we change this culture? We did already change that culture, for example, in schools. We don't, I don't know in English, but we're in 30 years ago, we gave what we call in Flanders pedagogische tik. So we pedagogically hit or slapped our children, because then they will be pay more attention and be smarter. That discussion is already done. That's over in educational settings. We know it doesn't help children long term. In sports, we are still starting this discussion for some of these behaviors. Physical punishment or physical punishment as a form of play or as a form of sanction and physical doing physical exercises, it's still too normalized at the moment. And I think this discussion is now starting. And many of these coaches will know personally where their line is. The question is, what do the athletes like? 60% of the athletes here in Wallonia and Brussels say that they don't like verbal, that they don't like all these verbal or physical ways of discipline that were used in sport. So I think that's very important to listen to them and start a discussion on how we can better pay attention to all of these signs and make sure that the training styles that we use are comfortable for every person involved and not only for the survivor of the fittest, the one that is very much resilient to these types of verbal or physical aggression.
Merci. Je ne vois plus de questions. Je passe. Merci.
Thank you for the presentation. You just highlighted that in the UK there is no such a thing as a high difference in figures. I was wondering how, I could see the recommendations that you're still advocating for a safeguarding system. And I was wondering how you still advocate for that with the UK, for instance. How you convince people that even though the figures are not showing some difference, it will be showing in the long term. Also, because you said you don't have figures on that yet. So if I can find mm-hmm. very difficult to still prove the point and make sure that it is understood. And also, I was wondering what you think is still missing in that kind of framework that has been put in place in the UK, for instance. And then what could you do?
Difficult questions. We have no other option. We have no other option than saying we need to put in place safeguarding systems. We're still trying to interpret and analyze the data and into the context of, for example, UK and Flanders, in which we have a longer tradition of safeguarding. And the main explanation will, of course, be higher awareness. And higher awareness, higher acknowledgement of what happened will always elevate the prevalence numbers. And that's a good thing. Also in the UK, there's lots more people that already report negative experiences to their reporting systems. For example, they have the child protection in sport unit where you can put complaints and get help. And there's high numbers. There's hundreds or even more per year that are being reported there. They also have disciplinary laws in sport that take place and that handle cases on a daily level. We don't have that here. In Flanders, it's only started this year that there's a Flemish tribunal for sport cases of maltreatment and violence. And we only have 10 cases this year. So does it mean it only happens to 10 athletes? No, it's just people don't know where to go. People don't know where to report. And if you don't have a proper reporting mechanism, of course you have no cases. So not having reported cases is not the same as not having problems in sports. So the UK is now working on this system. And they just started very late with their prevalence rates. I don't know what the first measure, the baseline measure would have been there. I don't know, we cannot say it. But I truly believe that, of course, working all of the different aspects of prevention and safeguarding, it will help in the end to get people informed and educated about the topic, and then only afterwards also prevent the problem. I'm super convinced that happens, and there's no other option. If you organize sport for children and vulnerable people, you need to make sure as a prerequisite that it's safe. And if you don't have contact person who can accommodate complaints and concerns, then you don't have no idea what you're doing. And I'm very strict on this, then you should better not organize sports. People who drop off their children at a sports group, they think it's a safe place. They give you the care of their child, and they need to do that knowing that the child is being treated in a safe way and can participate in sport in a safe way. So there's no other option there. Of course, I'm not a specialist in the UK system. I know they have lots of regulations in place on the worst cases of maltreatment. So they have a strict code of conduct, they have strict criminal laws, and they know how to handle these cases. I wonder whether they already managed to inform people at local level. That's a struggle I also pointed out in my presentation. It looks like their safeguarding policies are very nicely written and installed. I'm wondering whether every child, every parent, and every coach in local sport clubs in the UK know about this. I think the threshold is very high, certainly in bigger countries like the UK, to get help and information if you're working at a local level from the federation. I don't know any child that suffers maltreatment in sport club and says, let me call Sport England for help and advice. Doesn't help. It's too far away. And I think that's the main struggle that they now have. How can we make sure that local people that don't think about this topic much, that they are being educated there? So that last step, not from national to federal level of federations and sport organization, but from the federation level, bringing all the knowledge and the expertise to the local level, to people who are volunteering in a sport club, who don't have time, who don't have money to work on this issue. How can we make them aware and empowered to deal with this issue? And that's the final step. And that's the hardest step, of course. And it takes, I think, several decades. And that's what they are doing at the moment. And I think this is the work that you can start doing already right now. You don't have to work 20, 30 years. I think as soon as your federations are on board, help them and support them to bring the knowledge to the local sport level. And I think in no time you'll be there where they are, yeah, in prevention.
Merci, Tim.
Merci.
C'est la place à Monsieur Bollevé pour le mot de la fin.
Merci, Tim, pour cet exposé qui était vraiment très intéressant et qui, comme tu le disais, n'est pas péjoratif, mais une base de travail, un outil parmi d'autres. Comme tu l'as constaté, nous travaillons énormément sur les logiques de prévention. Il est toujours difficile de quantifier l'impact de la prévention, nous le savons, et donc ça nécessitera sans doute ce monitoring dont tu parlais et des études a posteriori, et nous serons très vigilants et nous aurons peut-être l'occasion de reparler ensemble à ce niveau-là. Tu parlais également de la question locale, très importante, ce qui me permet de faire le lien avec ce que la ministre disait. Nous avons la chance en Fédération Wallonie-Bruxelles d'avoir maintenant un décret éthique qui a été voté par le Parlement et qui institue un cadre précis en la matière avec la mise en place d'un observatoire et d'un réseau de référents. Je pense que ça va être un outil excessivement important sur lequel nous reviendrons auprès de vous tous. Je tiens en tout cas à te remercier pour ton intervention. Merci également les traductrices, hein, parce que c'est aussi un métier qui n'est quand même pas si facile que ça, de suivre des gens qui vont parler parfois très vite comme ça, et j'en suis un spécialiste. Grand merci à ce niveau-là. Il nous reste à vous dire que nous avons le rapport final, la synthèse du rapport final, la maltraitance des enfants dans le sport statistique européenne, qui est disponible à la sortie pour les gens qui sont en présentiel, pour vous qui êtes en visio, qui nous sera envoyé par mail. Je sais aussi que ces instants que nous avons vécus sont enregistrés et sont disponibles pour une période de 2 semaines, notamment pour les personnes qui se sont inscrites mais qui n'ont pas su nous joindre, on leur en fera part. Voilà, donc vous avez constaté que le chantier, il est important, mais essentiel, mais il revient à nous tous, hein, administration, intervenants de terrain, mouvements associatifs, fédérations, de continuer ce travail de sensibilisation, d'information, de formation, bref, de prévention à la maltraitance, le tout étant d'anticiper tant que faire se peut, mais en n'oubliant pas aussi que s'il y a prévention, nous devons être outillés aussi quand les situations sont présentes et avec la nécessité que chacun ait à sa disposition des outils dont il puisse se saisir, sachant que nous ne sommes pas tous des acteurs spécialisés de la maltraitance, mais que nous avons cette capacité de nous orienter vers les acteurs qui sont spécialisés, hein, savoir à qui s'adresser. Tim nous l'a bien rappelé, quand on est face à une situation difficile, vers qui est-ce que je vais? Voilà. Donc, voilà, nous sommes donc les premiers acteurs pour une pratique saine du sport dans le respect de l'intégrité. Je vais en rester là parce que le contenu était dense et que ça ne sert à rien de faire des conclusions à rallonge qui en dit tout le monde. Je le sais. Je vous souhaite en tout cas un bon appétit, une excellente après-midi et au plaisir de vous voir autour du même sujet. À bientôt. Merci.